Hi everyone, this is Rick. Today I'll be interviewing the CEO of JIOS Aerogel, Stephen Kang. JIOS is a company in Korea and Singapore that is using its patented JIOS AeroVa technology to create the lightest man-made material, aerogel, at an affordable cost. JIOS Aerogel powder is 3 times the weight of air, fire-resistant, hydrophobic, and can even dampen sound. Since its inception in 2013, has now created many applications, including the aerogel blanket, aerogel coating, tape, and many more.
Hey Stephen, to start us off, can you tell us a little bit about yourself as well as your company, JIOS?
Hey Rick. Yeah, so I'm actually a Korean by birth, but you can probably tell by my voice that I spent a long time in the UK. So I grew up in the UK, studied there. As soon as I got out of school, I actually joined finance world. So I was an investment banker for a very long time. And, you know, for most investment bankers back in those days, you know, you're Asian. So the best area to be right now, right back then, was Asia. So I was sent to Korea and the rest of the region. And so before I started JIOS, I was actually primarily in finance. And I specialized in trading, and I specialized in equity derivatives trading, so convertible bonds, stock options, etc. So that's something very different from what I'm doing now. So before JIOS, I started a hedge fund, actually in Singapore. One of the things we did do there was to look at what the industry calls side pocket deals, which is sort of private deals, smaller size, that you sort of put away for longer term with the potential to have outsized gains. And JIOS was one of those opportunities I saw. At around the same time, I was quite interested in doing something else, you know, finance. I've done it for 20 years. And when Charles introduced me to technology, Charles is a co-founder and head of our research and the inventor of our process. I was just completely intrigued that such a process could actually exist. I'd never heard or seen anything about aerogel before that time, and used to doing due diligence, and looking at different new technologies, and I was intrigued. So that's how I decided to join and help the company. Initially, really for funding and finance, etc. But as time passed, I became much more involved, and now I'm very much in charge of the entire business and really coming up with new wonderful applications using aerogel. Yeah. So JIOS, going back to that, is something that's unique in that aerogels have existed for a very, very long time, over 80 years. But what JIOS does really simplifies an otherwise extremely complicated process. And that's very important, because everybody understands the wonderful properties of aerogel and how it can impart these crazy performance attributes to old and new applications. But it's just been too expensive. And what we've done is really that this simplified process means that we can produce aerogel extremely cheaply, and that lets us sell aerogel to customers at a price that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I also checked out your website, and I saw the picture of the aerogel blanket, and then beneath that was a fire, and above that was a rose or some kind of flower, and I was like, wow, like, this thing is really cool. So that kind of relates to, you know, from the initial technology of JIOS AeroVa, is that the original patent technology? So how did you go from that into coming up with, you know, the aerogel blanket, the tape, the coating, all these different applications? How do you come up with these ideas?
We did it the hard way. So aerogels is a material, and really by itself, it's rather useless because it's an extremely light powder form that we make. So it just literally flies around in the air. So how do you manipulate this? So initially we just thought, well, we've got this wonderful process. So, you know, we'll just bring the price right down and then expect the market to just adopt it, you know, almost immediately. And first lesson learned, that's never the case. So we really had to go downstream, build applications for customers. And, you know, aerogel's been around for a long time, so actually, what we realized is that there's already an existing market for aerogel blankets. And it was invented actually by an American company, Aspen. Wonderful product. And we just thought, well, look, we can make something better. So we decided to actually make the blankets ourselves. And we invented the entire process from scratch and the equipment required to make aerogel blankets. And we do it separately. So we've got a process to make the powder. So we make the powder first. And then we had to design an entire line to make the aerogel blankets. And it took us 3-4 years to come up with that. Yeah. So again, we had to make the market or create the market and create the opportunity. And that was really a massive challenge for a small group of young people who, you know, never really had too much experience in engineering and in equipment manufacturing. And we did it all from scratch. A lot of headaches, a lot of heartaches along the way, but we managed to do it to the extent that in 2016, we came across a company called Armacell, and they're a European insulation manufacturing company. They were looking at aerogel technologies and aerogel blankets in particular. And so, you know, the stars are aligned. We had a good conversation, and 6 months later, we inked a joint venture. We haven't looked back since.
That's awesome. And so since running and starting JIOS, what has been the most challenging moment for you in running the business?
I can't think of one moment. There's challenging moments every day. But the biggest challenge really for us is, as I explained, we're a materials company. We make something really amazing, but on its own, you can't really do much. So the most challenging moment was, how do we take this unique technology and make and put it into stuff to make things great? So as a materials company, it's really realizing that technology, because you can only, you know, the technology is only as good as its commercial impact.
And to follow up on that, like, when you come up with a new idea, a new application, how do you know that, you know, customers would want it? Do you go about testing it and seeing how the feedback is and then iterating it? Or is there some other strategy?
Good question. Customer is always right. So you need to design applications and performance attributes the way the customer wants. In the beginning, you don't quite know. Yeah. So you need to prototype. Yeah. And you need to find customers who are willing to give you the feedback so that you can make those changes. And that's really hard. That's really hard, especially when you're talking to R&D departments. They've been bred to keep trade secrets and keep things internal. So it's really a big challenge. But remember, the most important thing is that it doesn't matter how good you think your product is if the customer doesn't. So it's part marketing, it's part R&D development, but really it's knowing what your customer wants. Sometimes you may know what the customer wants more than the customer, and it's up to you to persuade them of these performance attributes. But still, at the end of the day, it's all about making sure that your product meets the demand.
And kind of on the flip side of the most challenging thing, what would you say has been the best or most satisfying moment for you so far?
I would have to say that it was in 2018. When we built our first full-scale Apollo line. Apollo lines are our aerogel powder production lines. And so to that date, we had a pilot line that was capable of large-scale production. I mean, we called it a pilot line because, you know, it was manual and it was a hodgepodge of different equipment that we put together. And in 2018, it really culminated in a full-fledged, fully automated line. And first batch of aerogel that came out just blew us away. We didn't realize just how much better it would be. So our aerogel was already very, very good. In 2018, when we tested the stuff coming out, it was 30% better. And so, yes, that was really a defining moment.
And so it's been 7 years since the founding of JIOS. So where would you say you and JIOS are along the startup journey? So like, I'm assuming you're no longer constantly worried about the survival of your company.
No, we still are. We still are. It's very different from your generation I used to. So we are a traditional bricks and mortar business. On top of that, we are materials. And the cycles for these businesses are much longer and much slower than what you guys are used to. So, you know, when you're looking at e-commerce or the internet, everything's fast, fast, fast. Everything can scale very quickly. And within 6 months, you could have a massive business. It's not the case with, you know, bricks and mortar, and especially materials. We're still in that startup journey. So we're still in that journey of turning our company into a very stable business. And we're getting there. But really, the challenge for us has always been, it's a material that people know about. But it takes a long time for people to come up with wonderful applications. And, you know, that's what we've been doing. So the journey right now is where we're seeing that growth and that investment over the last 7 years coming to fruition.
And since it's such a long journey, what is keeping you motivated? Like, what keeps you focused and on track to build this company?
I think it's passion. So I'm sure you've heard of this term many times, but if you're not passionate about what you're doing, then you're not, you know, you're going to burn out. It's not about the money. The money always follows. But it's about being passionate about what you're doing, because that drives you to work harder than anyone else. That drives you to make things succeed when things are looking really gloomy. And it drives you to wake up when you don't want to, because things are really tough and hard, etc. So it's that passion and it's that belief in what you're doing is exciting, making a difference.
For sure. And do you have any advice for someone like me who is still a student, but I'm interested in entrepreneurship and wants to potentially start something of my own in the future?
I think the first thing is look at yourself and say, is this for me? Because it's very satisfying. But if you weigh the rewards of entrepreneurship and the downsides, and then there are plenty of downsides, it's not for everyone. So you need to ask yourself, am I willing to take that risk? Because it's very risky. Yeah? There's no job security. Yeah? There's no social security. Yeah? But if you're willing to do that, and you've got this underlying passion to create, to build, and to do something, and you don't want to belong in a large organization, I would say is that you need a certain sense of restlessness. You know, and restlessness could be just lack of focus, or, you know, something that's totally not fitting with entrepreneurship, but you'll know it. Yeah? If you've got that desire, then you have to do it, because you'll regret it. So I highly recommend that if you have that fire in your belly, go for it.
Gotcha. And then I also have some questions from the audience. The first one is, how do you handle the stress associated with running a startup?
Well, people do it in different ways. And I think bottling up that stress is probably the worst thing for you, your mind, and your body. So for me, I like to run. So when it's really quite heavy in terms of the stress, I literally put everything down and get into my running gear. And I just go for a long, gentle walk. I don't wear headphones or anything like that. It's just that calm, serene run, and it just calms you down and gives you that perspective to look from a high vantage point and sort of settle things. And usually I need to run every day.
Gotcha. And then do you have any book or podcast recommendations?
I've forgotten the name of it, but it's by Phil Knight. It's his biography. Autobiography.
Oh, the Shoe Dog.
Oh, yeah, Shoe Dog.
That's yes.
I thought that was wonderful, especially relevant to what we're doing. And you can see what mixture of life events need to come together for you to succeed. Yeah, so there's an enormous amount of luck, but there's also an enormous amount of sheer resilience. And third, and equally important, is the people that he surrounded himself. So you can't succeed on your own. You need to have a great group of people. And you shouldn't be afraid of making sure that everybody is aligned and incentivized as an entrepreneur to bring that wonderful team together.
That's awesome. I love that book as well. So before we end, I also prepared some rapid fire questions. The first one is, if you could have a superpower, what would it be?
flight.
And what time do you usually wake up every morning?
5:30.
And if you could have dinner with anyone, who would you choose?
My children.
And then if you are to start another business, what industry would it be in?
It wouldn't be materials.
Anything in particular or?
Video games. It's my other way to reduce stress is running and video games.
That's awesome. And so this is the last question, which is, what is the best advice you've ever received?
Don't look back.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you very much, Stephen. This is the end of the interview. Thank you for taking the time to do this. And I wish you and JIOS the best of luck.
Thank you, Rick.
I hope you liked this episode. If you want to see the latest previews, highlights, and takeaways from each interview, check out our Instagram. You can also listen to our podcast on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. All the links will be in the description below. Finally, leave a comment if there's a particular industry, founder, or question you would like to see asked in our interviews. With that, make sure you subscribe, and I'll see you next time.